Shocked that there was a person behind the voice.
As a voice talent, I was used to being invisible. Suddenly, I'm this persona. Hi, my name is Susan Bennett. And I'm a voice actor and the original voice of Siri.
iPhone 4 was groundbreaking. It's one of the best products we've ever designed, and it's gone on to become the number one smartphone in the world. And now, we're introducing Siri.
How can I help you?
Siri is a whole new way of interacting with your iPhone using just your voice.
Find me an Italian restaurant in North Beach.
Okay, these 25 Italian restaurants are in North Beach.
It's like this amazing assistant that listens to you, understands you, can answer your questions, and can even accomplish tasks for you.
Move my meeting with Kelly Altec to 12.
Note that you already have a meeting about budgets at 12 p.m. Shall I schedule this anyway?
Move it to 2.
A lot of devices can recognize the words you say. But the ability to understand what you mean and act on it, that's the breakthrough with Siri.
Read me my text.
New message from Tony Rivas. Are you going to the party?
Reply, yeah, I'll meet you there. Remind me to grab the present when I get home.
Here's your reminder for when you get home.
It completely changes the way you think about what a phone can do for you.
Everybody, and welcome to Buzz Talk Live. My guest tonight, Susan Bennett, is the original voice of Apple's iconic virtual assistant, Siri. As well as a vocal talent, Susan is also a singer and has appeared on hundreds of radio and TV commercials. She has gone from being a virtual unknown voice actor to becoming accidentally famous, with many appearances as a television and media personality. Currently, her vocal talents and voiceovers can be heard on countless numbers of radio and television broadcasts. She has given TEDx talks and has been asked to appear as an opening keynote speaker for many live corporate events, engaging audiences with her story about the profound effect Siri has had on her life. So please chat and welcome the original voice of Siri. Siri, are you there?
Hi, George.
Oh. Hi, Siri. How are you?
I am doing well. How about you?
Yeah, I'm doing well myself. I'm so honored to have you on the show tonight.
Well, thank you. Thank you for inviting me. And this does involve a huge amount of money, right?
What?
I mean, for me.
No, not at all. Not at all. No,
it's a little Siri joke there.
A little Siri joke. Well, I know I gotta speak in bits. You know, that's the only way Siri understands. So I speak in a lot of slang, but that's besides the point. No, seriously, it's great to have you on. You know, a lot of a long time ago, I mean, it's 10 years, right? This year
Siri turns 10 in October. Yep.
Yeah, that's awesome. And wow, and you're on Buzz Talk Live for the 10th year anniversary. So it didn't, you know, look, it didn't start this way with you. You like I said in my open, you accidentally became famous and everything with the whole Siri thing. But, you know, you really, your roots is in music, correct?
Yes. Yeah, I started playing the piano by ear at 4 years of age. And my parents weren't musical, but a next door neighbor heard me playing on this little toy piano, and he was about to move. He was an elderly gentleman, Mr. Chegner.
Mr. Chegner.
he was moving, and he gave me his upright piano. So that was a game changer for me. I took piano lessons for many years. And ended up being doing it professionally to a degree.
Yeah. I mean, we'll get into it because you've been, you know, backup singer with Roy Orbison and Burt Bacharach, and mm-hmm. I mean, my God, these are icons in music and everything. So, and I got some content here in the hopper, but let's start. You know, kind of like when things happened for you and broke for you at Siri, because. You know, being a voice talent, a voice actor, what is it? Voice talent, voice, what do you call yourself?
Either one. Yeah, voice talent, voice actor. Yeah.
Okay.
Either one.
So, you know, being that, I mean, you're behind the microphone, you have to train your voice, you're constantly developing, or is your voice developed?
Well...
You do like exercises?
Your voice changes as you age. So my voice is a little bit different than it was when I first started out years ago. But, you know, a lot of it has to do with how much you use your voice and if you take care of it and all of that kind of thing.
So a little tea there. You drink a little tea?
Yeah, a little tea. Yeah.
Tea with honey. Okay. No, but, you know, and it's demanding because, you know, a lot of the scripts that you receive, whether it be for a movie and, you know, or TV or anything like that, it's, you know, the scripts can be demanding and inflections and all this other stuff that you have to, you know, perform with and at. So what with Siri, though, did you like back into that gig? How did that happen for you?
I mean, what happened was I never actually worked with or for Apple. They got their voices from an IVR company called Nuance. IVR stands for Interactive Voice Response. So any voice that you hear on a GPS system, Siri, Alexa, Cortana, Google, any of those voices all came from these types of recordings. And so I worked for a company called Nuance, but I had a liaison company that actually got me involved because I worked for this company for many years and still do, doing a lot of messaging type of work.
Right.
But when I saw the IVR scripts, I thought, wow, what is this? And I've talked to other original Siri voices too, and they had the same experience, which was, we thought we were just doing, you know, generic sort of phone voices. There was no such, we had absolutely no idea that these recordings would turn into Siri or, you know, any of the other virtual assistants.
Right.
So it was kind of weird. The scripts that we had to read were created just for sound. They were trying to get all of the sound combinations in the language. And therefore, all of the phrases and sentences we had to read were pretty wacky because they made absolutely no sense. As I said, they weren't created for meaning. They were created just for sound. So I had to read phrases like, and these are actual phrases that I had to read that ultimately became part of Siri. Cow hoist in the tub hut today. Say schist fresh issue today. Militia oi hallucinate buckra okra ooze. And it was very tedious because the initial recordings were done for a month, 4 hours a day, 5 days a week. And so I was reading that sort of that babble for 4 hours a day, 5 days a week.
Yeah, no, I mean, but the babble, there was a reason for that for computer's sake, right? Because don't they develop like algorithms for the way when you speak in that language? Do they take bits of those spoken words?
I can't tell you really technically what goes on because that's one of life's great ironies.
Right.
The voice of Siri.
But I often wonder why they do it that way and not speak.
Well, because they would have this big bank of sounds, and what they would do is go into these recordings that were done with those crazy IVR scripts. And technicians and computers would go in and extract sounds, reform these sounds into new phrases and sentences.
Yes.
And these are what ended up on our devices as Siri and Alexa's answers.
and hence the way Siri speaks, she speaks in a bit, like, you know, like a computerized voice. And that's probably why it's done that way.
Well, it started off, she sounded a lot more robotic right at the beginning because, you know, that it was the beginning. And now 10 years later, you know, of course they changed the voice, but it's true of all, you know, the IVR voices there.
Yeah.
As technology improves and expands and, you know, grows, the sounds become more and more human. And because when you think about it, basically the original voice of Siri was actually pretty much the first public manifestation of AI.
Yeah.
You know, that Siri, and also the thing about the original voice is that she was a little snarky. You know, she had an attitude.
And
people loved that. They would ask Siri these ridiculous questions, and then she would give these absurd answers.
I think they still do that, Susan.
Possibly so, but the present Siri, she's a millennial, and she's just doesn't have that same attitude.
You know, it's funny. You're setting up a clip here, but you know, all over the internet, you know, there's always poking fun at things, and Siri is a big target where people poke fun of. So I found this clip on the internet. I think it's called Siri Humor is where it came from, but it's a guy just, you know, talking to his phone, and I'll run it here, and this is pretty funny.
Wake me up before you go.
Set the alarm for when?
Before you go.
Dan, I don't understand. Before you go.
Where is Steve Jobs?
I don't know who Steve Jobs is. Can you try again?
Where is Steve Jobs?
Sorry, I don't see Steve Jobs in your contacts. Can you try again?
Who is Apple's CEO?
Okay, here you go.
That's pretty funny. You know, it's snarky is saying it nicely. I mean, that's downright mean.
It's all in fun.
Yeah, no, I mean, and we have an early chat up there. Hey, Siri, from Dinger Bros. So, I mean, God, it's got to be like when you found out the news that that was your voice, you didn't know, right? Or
correct.
Tell that story.
Well, on October 4th, 2011, that's when Siri appeared. Yes, she's a Libra. a fellow voice actor emailed me and said, hey, we're playing around with this iPhone app. Isn't this you? And I went, what? So I went on the Apple site and listened, and I was kind of horrified, because a gig that big is something that you would think you would have had to audition for and audition for.
Sure.
But in the digital age, a lot of us voice actors are auditioning without even knowing it, because our voices are on different websites and agents' sites and things like that. So apparently I won the audition, but I had no idea.
And they didn't tell you? They didn't give you an email or anything to say, hey?
No, Apple did not get involved at all. Oh. In fact, I talked to one of the other original Siri voices, one of the original male voices, who was Daniel in England.
Right.
And he said that he tried to talk to Apple and see if he could work out a deal so that there could be some, you know, that maybe that he could make some money from it and promote Apple and all that stuff. They weren't interested. And I do believe one of the reasons that they ended up changing the voices is that the original Siri voices did not have an NDA, non-disclosure agreement.
Right.
Which means that we weren't paid for usage. We were paid for the recordings that we did.
Right.
But we were not paid for being on millions and millions
of iPhones. So they didn't make you sign anything, huh?
Apparently we signed the wrong thing.
apparently.
Read the fine print, people.
That's right. You got to read the fine print.
Yeah.
But listen, look, everything works out and everything's done for a reason. Lo and behold, someone found your voice and pointed you in the right direction. And voila, you became famous. I mean, my God, look at you. You're on magazines and everything. And somebody thought it would be a great idea to put you on the David Letterman show as Siri, of course, totally typecast. but I had this clip you doing the top 10 on David Letterman. Check this out.
Guess what? You know, you get these iPhones and you press a button and a woman will talk to you.
Sure.
Well, the identity and the woman's iPhone name is Siri, S-R-I.
That's the name of the gimmick on iPhone.
That's right. The voice of Apple's iPhone has been revealed. Yeah, her name is Susan Bennett from Atlanta, Georgia.
Oh, well.
We got a picture of her right there?
Oh, that's the voice of Siri. Well, nice-looking woman.
But don't you, when you take that gig, don't you say, well, will people know who it's me? No, nobody will know. And don't you then say, okay, I'm down with that. Anyway, things you don't want to hear from your iPhone. You ready, Paul?
Okay, sure.
Number 10. What do you want now?
All right, you don't want that.
Oh, this is an audio iPhone.
Yeah, we actually hear.
Oh, so you don't need me at all. Oh, you know. Oh, apparently she was kind enough to record the list for us.
Susan Bennett?
Yeah.
What, did they go to some little some crevice somewhere?
A cave in the Alps.
In Northern Ontario?
Yeah.
And find her?
Yeah.
I had her sequestered away.
Yeah,
How did they find her?
I don't know.
She's recorded this part.
Yeah.
The actual Susan
Bennett.
That's
right. So you don't need me. All I do is read the numbers.
Well, that's all. Yeah.
Now, may we start over? Things you don't want to hear from your iPhone. And now, ladies and gentlemen, the voice of Siri, Susan Bennett from Atlanta, Georgia. Here's number 10.
What do you want now?
Number 9.
It's been months since you've touched my home button.
Oh, that's naughty. Oh, that's naughty. Number 8.
Go sit in the truck.
Go sit in the truck. Number 7.
I have an itch. Would you mind pressing the 6 key?
Number 6.
Text message from Anthony Weiner.
Mm-hmm. I should be so lucky. Number 5.
Recalculating. Stupid GPS lady.
Number four.
I took pictures of you sleeping and sent them to your contact list.
Number three.
Turns out your father is Frank Sinatra.
Number two.
You have no messages, loser.
And the number one thing you don't want to hear from your iPhone.
You called that sexting?
That's awesome. And you know, the fact that, look at you, you're just making your own success and stardom and celebrity. It's great. But this year is like I said, it's the 10th anniversary of the iPhone 4S, where Siri became active, and now fast forward to today, you got all these other voices now. There's I often wondered, like, you know, you're the American women's voice, but then there's England and there's other countries that are involved. When they first developed this, was it like that? Was it, you know, thought out that way, or was it just wham, you know?
Well, I think the multiple voices came later. There were four original voices. The North American, British, who is male, and Australian, female. And I believe the fourth one was French, and he was also male. So they started out with four voices, and then ultimately, of course, you know, there became voices all over the world for different languages.
Yeah. As far as like character and stuff like that, because you do other characters, your character in as far as cartoons, and we'll get to it. Tilly, right? Tilly the all-time teller.
Yeah.
And that was a local gig in Atlanta that they came up with this great idea for a talking teller. Tell us about that.
Well, it was in the late 70s, and they were trying to introduce ATMs. And of course, this is way before personal computers, and certainly way before smartphones or anything like
right.
that. And people didn't trust, you know, a machine teller without a human being there with their money. They didn't like the idea of putting money into this machine or getting money out of this machine. So none of the ATMs were being used. And so this very clever group of people at McDonald's, a little advertising agency in Atlanta, decided, well, we need to personalize the machine. And so there you see Tilly's beautiful face there.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
they wrote a jingle about Tilly, and they hired me to be the voice of Tilly. And so that was my first appearance as a machine.
So I gotta ask, what does Tilly sound like?
I'm Tilly the all-time teller. I work for First National Bank.
Wow.
Yeah.
So that when you actually put your card in and put your code, that voice came out of the machine?
No. This was way before anything like that. This was a jingle that was played on the radio and TV and that sort of thing.
Okay.
Yeah. So to introduce Tilly to people.
I thought it was like more like interactive as far as you.
Oh, not in the 70s. No.
No.
They weren't there yet.
They weren't there yet.
That came much, much later.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, my God. That's awesome. Mm-hmm. And so, like, as far as you doing these voices and then getting going back to the iPhone, I guess my previous question was, you know, as far as developing a character for Siri, but it wasn't a character. It was really you. It was just your voice, right? The way mm-hmm. you spoke in a voiceover capacity, right? Is
right
in a controlled capacity, they took that and they created Siri from that.
Yeah, I just read, you know, single phrases and sentences that were created to get all the sound combinations in the language.
Wow!
And then, as I said, they would go in and extract sounds and you know, form them into new phrases and sentences, and that's what the virtual assistant said. But I did read something. That from one of the engineers who first worked on Siri, And when they were talking about the voice, they said they had been looking for a voice that was otherworldly, but had a very dry sense of humor. And so that's why, to me, the original Siri is so cool. And I'm really sad that now, you know, Siri now sounds like everybody else. So.
Well, no, I mean, you look, you were the standard. You became the standard of Siri, and now all the other voices that's come after you. How many were they after you? Do you know? Like,
I really don't. I'm certainly there were lots years, of different voices for Apple, and I'm sure, you know, Alexa came after that. And of course, she got very popular because she was in the Echo, and you could just have Alexa in your living room. And, I've always heard about this voice Cortana, but I've never heard her or where she came from, or was she the Microsoft voice? I don't know. And then the Google voice, of course. So, yeah.
And you're also in the Delta Airlines terminal.
I am in Delta Airlines gates worldwide.
So yes. if I'm strolling through with my bags, what do I hear?
Hi, George. I'm Susan with Delta Airlines, and I'm so sorry to tell you, you are in Zone Z.
That's great.
Too bad, George.
Too bad. Oh my God.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Oh, you can have a lot of fun with it. I mean, you know, you do other voices too. There's I think character voices that you also do. Madame Francesca. Madame Francesca.
Yep, fortune teller.
Fortune teller. Okay.
Yeah. I read the crystal ball for you. I see. You will meet tall, dark stranger.
Now, what was that used for?
Nothing. Yeah.
No, it was just a
character. There are some voices that I had some, there was this really cute website that was created for kids, and it really taught them how, you know, music and all different kinds of things. And I did a lot of the characters for that particular website. And for me, I love to do voices. So I do a lot of voices during my Siri speaker events and that sort of thing. So now, Madame Francesca is one of the speaker event voices.
How did you gain this talent as far as doing voices like this and creating these characters? Because you brought up in music, you play the piano and keyboards and whatnot. So how did this all come to be? Just by singing or...
Well, I think I think a lot of it has to do with having a good ear. There are a lot of voice actors that do come from music that started as singers. And a lot of reading scripts and stuff has a bit to do with rhythm. You know, so you have a good feel of the timing and that sort of thing. So I think you'll find a lot of musicians and singers that became voice actors.
That's
so for me, it was basically... Basically, I can mostly imitate sounds. If I hear other sounds, I can get close to that sound, or I can invent a sound for a particular character. And it's just kind of fun. I really haven't had too much opportunity to do that in my career. I used to do a lot of different voices when I did lots of radio and TV commercials. But when my voice was revealed as being Siri, I sort of knew that I was going to be typecast when I revealed myself. It took me a long time to reveal myself. My husband and son just kept pestering me about it and said, oh, it's such a unique opportunity, you've got to do it. Finally, the stars aligned or something, and I decided, yeah, I really should. And it turned out to be a very interesting thing because I had all of these opportunities. Yeah. And as far as the David Letterman thing, I got to tell you, he did not know that I wasn't going to be there. Oh. And when Tom Hanks was the next one to come up after the top 10 list, and he said, so Dave, you didn't make it to rehearsal today, eh?
Where?
Because Dave was pretty nasty to me, you'll have to say.
Really?
You heard the clip. He was not nice.
No, but was that a live read that you did, or was that recorded?
Oh, I recorded it at home. What had happened is that this was the flurry of the right at the beginning of doing, you know, revealing myself as Siri and doing all these. I mean, I did hundreds of radio and TV, you know, interviews and appearances and all that kind of thing. And so I had just flown back from New York and they wanted me to fly back just to do the top 10 list. And I was supposed to go to Los Angeles that same week too. And I said, oh, well, can I do it? Can I record it from home? And so they, you know, I just recorded it via ISDN with the people from, yeah, from the Letterman show. Yeah. And that was that.
And that was that. Yeah. No, that was, hey, you got to cut corners the way you have. And there's a chat there. Did you go to any college for voiceover acting? I don't know. I mean, I don't think so. Did you?
Well, I don't really think there are colleges for voiceover acting. Voiceover is really, most of the people that end up doing voiceover are, you know, you have to have a good voice or an interesting voice or a clear voice.
Right.
But you also have to be able to act, depending on what type of aspect of voiceover, because there are so many aspects,
sure,
to the voiceover business. You know, radio and TV commercials, animation, gaming. But then there are straight ahead things like narrations, reading, yeah, the news, you know, that kind of thing. And so basically there are coaches out there, some very good coaches, voice coaches.
Right.
And I always tell people that whatever aspect of acting they want to get into, even voice, make yourself go do improv, because it helps you really think on your feet, and helps you with your just general performance.
Right. So you got the fame of Siri, and you're riding that fame a little bit. And then you happen to bump into Steve Wozniak, right?
Mm-hmm.
And
yes, I met him at a tech conference.
Yeah. And actually, tell us that story. That's an interesting story.
Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, I'm saying that's an interesting story. I want you to tell that story.
Well, I did a bunch of tech conferences for a company called Tech Media. And this one, I believe this was in Dallas. Yes. And I met Steve Wozniak there. And he's such a great guy. He's very interested. He and his wife are very into education and helping students and kids. And he was just wonderful to all the attendees at that place. He would sit down and talk just, you know, forever with these kids answering their questions. And I had a chance to talk to him myself. And he told me, he said, I really think that you have a career doing this. He said, you are very at ease on stage. He said, you really ought to think about doing this. And for a while, my agent tried to get me booked with him. And but the thing is, I think he charges hundreds of thousands of dollars. And so by the time a company was going to pay that, they didn't want to throw any more money.
Might not be
in
that league yet, right?
but he was very, very encouraging. And he's basically the reason that I ended up getting into doing speaker events.
Yeah. And there you are. You're on stage doing your thing. You did a TEDx talk, mm-hmm, you know, and speaking as a public speaker, a motivational speaker, with one of these, you know, corporations that reach out to you and speak to their sales force or whatever, given the topic. And does the crowd, I mean, you have the Siri persona, so you use that to your advantage with your public speaking, and you develop a certain custom niche for that particular group. Is that it?
Basically, the story that I have to tell is the same, but I do customize all of my, you know, my presentations depending on who the audience is and exactly what,
right,
they're looking for, what they're, you know, like I would do a different presentation for a group of, you know, women, you know, real estate agents than I would for a bunch of techie people.
Right, right, right.
But basically the presentation is the same, in that I talk about how Siri, the recordings were done and mm-hmm, mm-hmm, you know, where Siri really came from. And then I talk a lot about the voiceover business and do a lot of different character voices just for entertainment factor. And then I also talk about, you know, in the motivational sense, I talk a lot about how difficult it was for me to embrace my inner Siri. It was just weird that all of a sudden my voice was on, you know, everywhere.
Yeah.
And I knew that that when your voice is that ubiquitous, it's sort of like, gee, how is this affecting my voiceover career?
Yeah.
And so that's why it took me a long time to reveal myself. I really was afraid of the impact it would have on my career. And I'll explain that, because normally when you hear a voice that's giving out information, you don't really pay attention to the voice. You pay attention to the information that you're looking for. Mm-hmm. You know, if someone calls up and you get a message, you know, you're not noticing the voice particularly, unless it's a, you know, a character voice, or unless it's a celebrity voice. But when suddenly that voice becomes something like Siri, that's in your pocket, you know, 24/7,
you take
just
notice,
about,
right?
And you talk to this voice, you know, many, many times a day, and you become very familiar with that voice, even subconsciously, you don't realize it. And so I have no way of measuring how being the voice of Siri has affected my voiceover career, but I do know that I was a bit typecast after I revealed myself. Yeah. I'm cast very, very often as the computer voice, the robot voice.
Robot voice.
I was in I played the submarine in the movie about the giant shark, the Meg. So, of course, I was the talking submarine, you know. Yeah. So, but actually, it's really all been fun. So I really can't complain.
I have a clip here of a movie that recently came out, December of last year, actually, and it has to do with the pandemic, and I guess the. They created a movie about the pandemic. How original is that? But yeah,
that's what we want to see, right?
That's what we want to see right now.
More isolation and death.
That's what we want to see.
I can't get enough.
No, but I want to show the clip, because you're a big part of this movie, but your voice is a big part of it.
Oh, as usual, I'm telling everyone what to do.
Exactly. So I have a clip of the trailer. Let's take a look.
Good morning, Miss Garcia.
Good morning, sunshine. I miss you. I could kiss you right now.
Yeah, well, someday.
Curfew is now in effect. All unauthorized citizens must stay indoors.
Tensions rise as we enter the 213th week of lockdown.
A grim new reality emerges.
COVID-23 has mutated.
Beginning thermal scan. Thermal scan normal.
A horrifying new development
new
today.
New data confirms the virus attacks the brain tissue.
Whoa! I'm immune!
Worldwide death toll rises to over 110 million.
All infected Americans are being forced into quarantine camps.
Sarah,
what's going on?
Department of Sanitation.
Sarah, talk to me.
I think my neighbor has a fever.
It'll be so much easier if you just open the door. Mrs. Grant, you have visitors.
Sarah, please. Sarah, open that door.
Sarah, do not open that door.
No! Please! I'm not safe!
Guards will be arriving in 4 to 6 hours. You must not attempt to leave your home, or you will be shot on sight.
Oh my God!
Yikes!
Jeez! Shot on sight. Is that where we're going?
That's bad.
That's really bad. Oh my
That's
God!
Really bad.
Now something like that? You're just brought in to do a read. Did you know that this was a movie, or was it just?
Yes. Yeah. I actually worked from my home studio and, you know, worked with them via Source Connect.
Right.
Yeah.
Huh. No, that's, hey, look, you know, and there's others too. you did something. I don't have a clip though of it, but you did something with the comic, the insult dog.
Oh yes. Triumph.
Triumph, Insult Comics.
That was back a few years when they tried to have Robert Smigel, who was with SNL for a long time, funny guy. Yeah, and he's got a creative Triumph. I adore Triumph. He's so awful.
He's awesome. Yeah, I know. I love that character.
They were trying to have this show. It was called the Jack and Triumph Show, and it starred Jack McBrayer from 30 Rock.
Okay.
And so I got to actually be in an episode. And
as Siri.
Yeah, as Siri. Yeah, they threw Siri in jail.
Oh wow. Siri in jail? Seriously? Oh. Where's the comedy in that?
Oh, it was funny, darling. I loved it.
So going back a little bit, more than a little bit, but these iconic rock and rollers and performers, Roy Orbison and Burt Bacharach, how did you get hooked up with Roy Orbison?
Well, I worked with Burt Bacharach first, and basically it came from the fact that I was a jingle singer and a backup vocalist, and I worked in a lot of studios in Atlanta. And Atlanta's a pretty happening place, especially now. And so they were putting together, Burt Bacharach had his basic rhythm section, and he had two featured singers that he brought with him. And then he hired me and two other singers from Atlanta. And because he was starting off his tour in Atlanta. Now that's from the Roy Orbison, that's not Burt. There now is, I'm Roy. On the left with the short hair. Uh-huh, yeah. What a surprise. And yes, the three of us were on tour with Roy for a couple of years. And Roy sort of never went away, even though, you know, he had a period of time where you didn't hear much about him until he got back with the Traveling Wilburys in the late 80s. But in the early 80s, we traveled all over the world, you know, singing backup for Roy. So it was quite an experience.
I have a clip of you singing backup with Roy Orbison. Check it out.
All right.
Beautiful Lana, I told her my mama and my dad, what I had was the sweetest and the neatest little girl in the world. Oh, Lana, la 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 Lana, Lana, la la Lana. Hey,
great. That was great. I mean, And to tour with him was probably incredible, part of your life.
It was incredible. Yeah, it was truly amazing. That I would have to say that wasn't one of my favorite songs. That's kind of a novelty song. I think.
There's not many to choose from out there that you were, you know. I was trying to find a clip that you were kind of like, you know, shown more. Then there was others that were in black and white with Bruce Springsteen and
yeah, that was after our time. Yeah,
that was that you?
After
was that you
and then he started to, you know, kind of get
right
kind of a thing again. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I mean, to have Elvis say that he had the greatest voice, that's saying something.
Yeah, Roy. People loved Roy. You know, I was with him during the time, as I said, that he was sort of between being, you know, times of his being most famous.
Right.
And but we traveled all over the world and they absolutely loved him. We went to, you know, the British Isles. We went to Australia. We went to Bulgaria. My first gig with him was in Bulgaria.
Bulgaria.
In front of televised to 10 million people. So if you can imagine, Bulgaria, really? You know, he was famous there. He was famous worldwide. So that was a lot of fun. And I did get to sing. I did get to play Emmy Lou Harris. I got to sing a duet with him on that song called That Loving You Feeling Again. And you may not have been able to find it because it was on Austin City Limits, but there's a shortened version and then a longer version. And it's not in the shorter version. It's in the longer version. But that was really cool. It was really, really just amazingly fun to sing with him.
Yeah, I bet. I mean, just traveling around with Roy Orbison, my God, that's great. He's an iconic singer in that time frame, and a lot of people around him became really big stars, you know, in today's standards, you know. So what else we have for you, Susan? I mean, as far as like what you're doing now, you're still creating voices or creating tracks for projects and whatnot. You're doing work at home, obviously. But are you working on anything that's fresh and new or?
Well, not really at this particular point in time. Last year at the beginning of 2020, I was really, you know, going great guns for the first couple of months. I had several Siri speaker events and then COVID decided to change all that. And then finally I did do, I think, three or four virtual Siri events, which were, you know, it's not as much fun because you don't get to interact with the audience, but it was still fun to just, you know, do it and have some work. I really love to work. So
yeah.
Anybody listening out there, I'm, you know, Siri for hire.
Now, where can they find you? Where can they find you as far as to hire you?
Well, you can reach out to me through my website, which is SusanCBennett.com. Or you can reach out to my agents at Vox Inc. in Los Angeles. And you can just go online and look up Vox Inc. It's Wes Vox Stevens Inc. or Tom Lawless at Vox. They do all my booking. And so for the most part, my husband is an incredibly talented musician and writer and audio engineer. And so he's been putting together a couple of albums. He and I were singing last year with a band called the Canyon Ladies. And we were doing all the music from the female singer-songwriters of Laurel Canyon in the 1960s. So people like Joni Mitchell, Carole King, Bonnie Raitt, Linda Ronstadt. And so really, really fun.
Your husband is a session guitarist? Am I saying that correctly?
He's done sessions and he's been in lots of different bands. He used to travel around the South with the Tams, if you've ever heard about the Tams. And he's just been a working musician all his life. And now he's putting together an album for the Canyon Ladies, and he's also putting his own album together.
And you gig with him, right? You're gigging with him a little bit, right, around town?
Oh yeah, we had a private event band for 25 years.
Yeah, there you are. That's great. And you got that 70s theme going on there.
Yep, 60s and 70s, some 80s. you know, a little bit of everything thrown in.
That's good. That's good.
Yeah.
Good for you, Susan. I mean, it was so enjoyable to have you on the show tonight and to go through, you know, your wonderful career as Siri and the development of your voice acting and all that stuff. And I'm so honored to have you on the show.
Well, thank you.
Yeah. No, I mean, this was great. A great night to hear Siri on the show. And I have to ask if you can just maybe end the show with something that Siri could say.
Siri has had an excellent time talking to you, George, and I would like to invite everyone to listen to all of George's broadcasts. So, for Siri, this is Siri saying bye.
Wow. Wow, I think I'm going to clip that and save it. That's great, Siri. Susan, see? You see? You made me say Siri. Yeah. that's great. Thank you so much. Thanks.
Thank you.
All right. Oh, my God. Susan was great. And just to hear where Siri came from and to hear it live on the show, you just can't get any better than that. Best of luck with her and her career going forward, and hopefully, you know, we get some live events. She can go on stage and make lots of people happy and speaking and all that good stuff. So tune in next Sunday night at 8:30. We're going to have an award-winning stage, film, TV actress, producer, and writer. Eileen Gruber is going to be here. She's also passionate about speaking as an advocate for the disabled in the arts community. So she's going to be on the show here on next Sunday night at 8:30 p.m. here on the Buzz Talk Live show. That's it for tonight, and good night, America.